science. My background is agronomy, was agronomy in my undergrad, and I work with crop plants. But then, in my PhD, I got into Arabidopsis, and I had to work with yeast as well, because doing genetic manipulation was easy doing it on yeast than in Arabidopsis, because of the difficulties that Arabidopsis or any other higher model organism would brings as compared to yeast. Okay, so that's why I will be talking about things that I did with Arabidopsis and also with yeast. But for the last 2 years, I have been working also with the human protein, not because I'm not an animal biologist, I'm a plant and yeast, but what I do, that's the beauty of molecular biology. Whatever you use, you can apply it to many different fields. Plant science, pharmacology, or pharmaceutical things, to biotech companies, to humans, to animals, and so on, or different types of industry. So that's why I got into the human aspect of my research, which I may share, if I have enough time, I may share some with you. But I was mainly working on stress response in plants, and I start, what's stress? You hear is a very common word, used and abused most of the time. I'm under stress. Anything that perturbs your normal biological functioning, you can consider it a cause of stress or a type of stress. And so we have what? Different types of stress. And what is the usual response? You alter gene expression, your cellular metabolism, and even in case of crop, so change in growth rate and crop yields. But also, humans are subject to stress as well. And how species deal with stress? Oh, you have, so different species deals with stress differently and is based on what? Or even the same species may have different genotypes that may allow one individual of the same species deal with stress different than the other one. That's why you see, for example, farmers in plant science or animal science that selects, or this organism or this individual is more resistant to this type of disease or to this microorganism, or this crop, this type of plant, when there's not a lot of rain, it produces, at least you have something guaranteed. So within the same species, the genotype may make a difference, okay? And also the age, the developmental stage of the individual may have also an effect on stress. Now, as I told you at the beginning, I work with plants. And when I start my PhD program, I was interested in studying a compound that accumulates in response to many different types of stress. And that compound is called GABA. GABA is an amino acid that is not part of any protein. It's a non-protein amino acid. And it was discovered in 1949 in potato tubers. It didn't get as much attention until later on they discovered that also you find it in the central and the peripheral nervous system of animals and is a major neurotransmitter inhibitor. And several studies have found that every time you submit a plant to any kind of stress, there's a spike in GABA accumulation. Then you ask, what's GABA doing in plants? Why every time you have a stress situation, there is a spike in GABA accumulation? There are many other things that accumulate that can work as osmolytes, osmotic balance, and so on. But GABA, when they saw the accumulation, and nobody knew exactly what's the effect or the function of GABA. So that's how I start studying this in my PhD program. And as you can see, in plants, so you find GABA in animal system, but also you find it in plants and you find it in yeast. to tell you about a little bit about this compound, is a omega amino acid. It does not have the same structure that you have the chiral carbon, the carbon that everything that is attached to it in the four bonds it can make, you find something different attached to each bond. That's the chiral carbon. GABA doesn't have it, because the amino group that you find in the carbon, in that chiral carbon, is not actually in that position that you call the alpha carbon, but is at the end of the chain. And GABA has four carbon, it's a four carbon compound. That's why it's called omega amino acid. And there are a group of omegas amino acid. And GABA in plants, or in most plants, comes from glutamate, which is an amino acid that go through the decarboxylation process. It loses a carbon, it becomes GABA. Okay? And there is, so this one, GAD, is glutamate decarboxylase. It decarboxylates, moves the carbon from glutamate, it creates GABA. It's in the cytoplasm. But the other enzyme that catabolizes GABA is called GABA aminotransferase. In plants, is in the mitochondria, as you see, but in yeast, is in the cytoplasm. So when plants produce GABA, here, GABA is shuttled into the mitochondria. In the mitochondria, this enzyme, which is the one that I was chasing during my PhD, because nobody knew much about that enzyme yet and how it worked. So that was my main goal, to clone and characterize that enzyme. I did it, but I was scooped by someone in Canada that had been working on it previous to 1995, and I started working on it in 97. And I still clone it before he did, but he scooped me because he found out the sequence, the DNA sequence, and publish it and submit for a patent, which, as far as I'm concerned, it's wrong. Nobody creates it, nobody should patent a gene. That's my opinion, okay? But I was scooped. But I still found out about the effect of the function of that compound, what else it does. GABA can do what? GABA can act as a source of carbon and nitrogen, like many other amino acids. But in addition to, GABA works as a signaling molecule. That's something that I produced and I published that document many years ago. So it's working as a signaling molecule, and also it's work as a source of carbon and nitrogen. And right now I have a student working purifying, expressing and purifying this enzyme from plants, but also from yeast. Because this enzyme, this GABA aminotransferase, when it catabolizes GABA, it sends the amino group, the NH3, if you want, from GABA to pyruvate, which is an organic acid, produces alanine. So when you do, you use GABA as a source of ammonium, to give the ammonium, and put that ammonium to pyruvate, pyruvate becomes alanine, an amino acid. The yeast one takes GABA, takes the amino group from GABA, does not transfer to pyruvate, but it transfers it to what? To oxoglutarate, and creates glutamate again. The same scientist from Canada claimed that the plant ones can use also both. Well, he showed it, but then when he purifies the enzyme, very pure, he saw no activity when he used oxoglutarate. He still claimed, but in 2000, he published another paper saying that, no, I was wrong. And right now, I have a student that is working in purifying this enzyme from plant, but also the one from yeast. And then we are going to use a new technology that we don't have at UTC. It's too costly. So you will put the two proteins, the one from the plants and one from the yeast, They are kind of orthologs, if you want. Those are same thing, but in different species. They do the same thing, one in one species, one in another species. They may have come from the same stem, but they differentiate. They go through different species, which leads to species. So they are considered to be orthologs. So what they will be doing, this student will produce those and bring it to that machine. You put that protein in a chip, and we run those compounds, and we see if actually the one from plant can bind to both of them. So that's the something that I have the student doing, and hopefully we will succeed. So I don't want to take too much time to talk about GABA, but all the work we did with GABA led my interest in finding exactly what GABA does and why it does what it does. So, as I told you, if this is GABA, GABA is can be related to what? Alanine, glutamate, but glutamate is related to what? To oxoglutarate, but also glutamate can go to glutamine, glutamate to aspartate, and aspartate and asparagine. All these amino acids, I had to study them to see if by having that close metabolic relationship with GABA, would they have similar effect on plants as does GABA? That's what I had to continue studying them, and I will not present you everything I have done with that, but also I look into other omega amino acids, and here is the what I told you. This is a list of omega amino acids, and I studied most of them, but later on I only emphasize my studies in the beta-alanine. So we have glycine, the first one. We have beta-alanine, which is another omega amino acid. We have GABA, which is gamma-aminobutyric acid or gamma-aminobutyrate. And we have also one that is 5-carbon compound that's called delta-aminovaleric acid or delta-aminovalerate. So now you see what I told you. Look the where the amino group is in the last carbon of the chain. Glycine, which is the smallest amino acid, is part of that amino group of amino acids, and it happens that due to its structure, the amino group is in the last carbon because it only has 2 carbon. Okay, that's why sometimes they are referred to amino acetic acid, because acetic acid has 2 carbon as well. So what I did, most of the studies I was doing to find the effect of GABA in plant system, I was studying its effect on root and shoot development. And when I look the root length, and when I use glycine, I see that when I increase the concentration of glycine, as I go, everything shuts down, and almost at the same rate. And when I get to 10 millimolar, and I have no growth. When I use asparagine, similar trend, and then everything shoots down. Aspartate only start getting harmful at 50 millimolar concentration. Then I use beta-alanine, and beta-alanine starts knocking down all the growth, but the rate of decline is higher at a lower level concentration of salt as compared to the higher concentration of salt. So I use Marshigan Skoog salt, MS salt, and I use what I call 1x, full concentration, which is 1x, and 1/8 of that concentration, which is gives you basically reduce the concentration to an 1/8 part of the full strength. And because I had seen some difference with GABA as well between full and 1/8 strength. Then I did the same approach for the omega amino acid. So, and I saw this difference in the growth. Then I said, well, why is with the beta-alanine at 1/8 strength MS, why such difference Is there anything in the full strength MS that makes it more less susceptible to root growth? Because I look at the root length and also the shoot. So how do you find out? If I have everything at 1/8, I see one pattern. And I put everything at full, I see another. Is there anything when I bring the concentration to full strength? Is the combination of all ions, or is there a specific ion that does it? That would be the next study. So what I did in this graph, I prepared the basic 1/8 MS salt. So I had to prepare individual chemicals, individual ions that you find in the MS salt composition, and I maintained the basal level at 1/8, and then I put one ion at a time to the level of full 1x. And what did I find? Which one would be your candidate here? Look at the list of ions. Which one, and the blue is what is at, with betalanin at 1/8, but the ion that you see is the one that was raised to the level of full strength. Which ion you see that at the level of full would minimize the decrease in root length? Potassium. Okay? Potassium. Why? I keep everything at A strength, and I just bring potassium to the level of full strength. Even though at full strength, there is a decrease in root growth due to the presence of beta-alanine, but that decrease is less than the decrease you see when the in the A strength, when you bring nitrate to full strength, ammonium to full, phosphate to full, calcium to full, any of them. Look, potassium, that's the root length. There's a quite significant increase as compared to the rest of the treatments. Then I said, well, if potassium is the one that is minimizing the root decrease when you have full strength MS salt, what's the role of potassium? As you may know, potassium is a very good and important osmolite among the inorganic osmolites, okay? And potassium is very important in lowering the osmotic potential in the cell to help the cells, mainly plants when they are suffering drought. If they have good potassium nutrition, they tend to suffer less. Even the stomata movement, the presence of potassium in the guard cells can help actually the movement of the guard cells and shut or open the stomata and help the plants to withstand drought stress. So what's potassium doing? And at which level of potassium, at which potassium concentration actually does it make a difference between total root inhibition or to minimize the impact of betalanin on root inhibition? So we run a potassium gradient. So we start with zero potassium and we start increasing the concentration. And we saw that in both, there is an increase mainly until what? About between 7.5 to 10 millimolar, and then you reach a plateau. And this is the root length, and this is the number of leaves. That's what we have. And similar result in the root leaf number and also in the root length. Now, we know that potassium is doing minimizing the root growth, but what else is potassium doing? This one, the top panel, is eighth strength without betalanina. The bottom panel, C, the full strength without betalanina. Full strength with betalanina. Look the difference in the root growth and look the difference in the color. There's a decrease in the greenish, which probably is related to the content of chlorophyll as compared to this. And here, when we have eighth strength without betalanin and look the eighth strength with betalanin. How is the growth? The plant is totally chlorotic. This may lead to what? We believe that there is some influence of betalanin in the nitrogen metabolism, but also there is a problem with the root growth. A bigger inhibition at low level of salt as compared to full strength. We thought two things. There is a osmotic issue, something related to water movement, that may you may lose potassium or you may have potassium deficiency due to the presence of betalanin. Betalanin is interfering with the ability of plant to take up potassium. So there's a problem with the transporter, or there's something else related to nitrogen metabolism. So we continue studying. Now I ask, since you put this, you see this growth inhibition, and actually, depending on the level of betalanin, you can even inhibit the germination. One of the students that just graduated, and he may start now his PhD and at UAB, I came to my lab and I asked him, I want to continue this study. Would you take this task? He said, yes. Then first thing I asked him to do is, we need to know if the effect of betalanin is upon germination, or even after germination, betalanin could have the same effect on root growth. So what we did, we grew plants, the same Arabidopsis, until they, after germination, to a size of 1 centimeter. And then we did what? We flip it. So these plants were grown in 1/8 ms without any betalanin. And then my student got the plant and transferred them and put them upside down. If there's any growth after transfer, then what would happen to the root? Due to gravitropism, the root would bend. If you see no bending, you see a slight bending here, right? But nothing, it stays straight, which means there was no growth. So betalanin would affect the growth either before or later after germination. And in addition to zero growth, look the chlorosis. Those were green plants that were transferred here, and now they are white. And here we have full strength. There is still some problem, no additional growth, but you find a couple of plants that still maintain the green color. When you put a strength without betalanin, you see the bending, it grew, it bent over, grew and bent over. The same thing happens at full strength. So this led us to conclude that, yes, in both cases, betalanin can have this inhibitory effect before and after. Now, to see if there was any problem with nitrogen metabolism, betalanin is related to the metabolism of polyamines. Which ones? Putrescine, spermine, spermidine, and also ornithine. And also, those, at least putrescine, they have shown in literature some relationship between putrescine and potassium. Having this issue with betalanin, with potassium, and also having betalanin, so polyamines with potassium, and polyamines with betalanin, so we decide to see if there was something related to the accumulation of polyamine in those four different treatments that we had. Full strength with and without betalanin, a strength with and without betalanin. And first thing he did was to run an HPLC profile with old standards and see if he could detect the polyamines. And here in the right, or in my right, you see the profile. So putrescine, this retention time, spermidine, and spermine. Yes, he could detect all of them. So what he did, he started preparing the samples and went through. Those are standards that we bought. And here are the ones that he did, and actually determine the presence of polyamines in those four treatments. As you can see, the first one, putrescine, you have eighth with and without, full without and with betalanin. As you can see, in putrescine, when you go from what? You go from absence to presence of betalanin, you have an increase in putrescine content. Same thing happened here in the full strength, but the increase was much milder than what you saw in eighth strength MS salt, which was the one that ended up having high root inhibition and the higher discoloration. What happened to spermidine? Spermidine did not respond to betalanin treatment, but it responded to the treatment of the salt. So there was no relationship with betalanin when it comes to spermidine. And spermine had a different, also respond to betalanin, but there was a, basically, we didn't detect spermidine in ACE trans with betalanin, and we detect very low level of spermine, I'm making confusion. So spermine decrease in both treatments with the presence of betalanin. Here the response was more to salt than to presence or absence of betalanin. So we had three different responses, and this was three samples that he ran, and three samples for each one. So he had it in triplicate. And I have another student that's going to run it another time. And if we confirm the same trend, then this is ready to go out for publication. Now, I told you about potassium and also the presence of betalanin. If you see that there's a problem with growth, there's a problem with potassium and problem with this putrescine, so more likely the presence of betalanin may be affecting what? The potassium transporter system. And it happened that there are two different types of transporter system of potassium. There's what you call the high affinity and low affinity potassium transporter. So I had a student that tried to see if betalanin had any effect on the gene expression of those potassium transporters. And she did a few work, so, but before I move into that, so my student came up, after all this work, he came up with this hypothesis that can lead to future work on this, that the presence of betalanin in the growth medium affects both potassium transporter system in Arabidopsis thaliana, which in turn affects root elongation and other growth patterns. Because sometimes cell expands by filling up with water, and that's how cell expand. If you see, for example, plants that are going through drought stress, water shortage, the internodes tend to be short. It's like if you are malnourished, you will not develop to your full capacity. And when you say, well, there's growth, what determines growth? Growth is due to an increase in number and size of cells, right? You may have the same number of cells, but if those cells are not expanding, then there will be no significant growth. So that's why he said, well, if betalanin takes potassium into the cell can pull more water because you lower the osmotic potential. So that cell can expand, because by getting water into the cell, you expand and stretch the cell wall, and that cell tend to expand. So this would lead to what? Larger root growth. And also, you think that betalanin and and potassium gene expression and subsequent effect on primary root growth in Arabidopsis thaliana. Maybe the presence of betalanin is affecting the uptake of potassium by affecting the expression of genes that encodes potassium transporters. And that's when a different student tried to use two different potassium transporters, one of high affinity and with low affinity. If you have high affinity, I don't need to give you much to start taking it in. The low affinity, you have to basically load the medium with potassium before they can kick in and start taking up. So to know this, that's why she had to focus on both, one of high affinity and one of low affinity. And actually, she identified these five potassium transporters, and she wanted to study them, but she did somewhat a work that was not finished, and she was learning and eager to go to med school. That's one of the problems that we have with our research. One half of the students that we get wants to go to a pre-professional program or a professional program. So she was about to finish, and I just present this. Part of the work was done well, like this standard regression, which she used different concentration of the DNA then to run the qPCR, and very nice standard curve. And she tried to look to quantify the presence of those, the gene expression of those genes using real-time PCR in both root and shoot at different time, but this is not a conclusive, this is not a result that actually I would make too much faith on it. And I put it, I knew that in my audience I would have students, and this is one of the things that hurts us the most. Most of students that we get are pre-professionals. They want to do research because it will look good on CV, and this is the kind of result you get sometimes. I have been fortunate now. I have students, and I have become selective. I only take students as a sophomore, and I have actually taken two freshmen, and one just went to a conference in a SOCON conference in South Carolina. So now I told you, now I'm switching gear between what I have done in Arabidopsis into yeast. And why I start working in yeast system? I start working in yeast system because, first of all, it's easy for the manipulation of genetic manipulation, because you can mutate the cell by doing yeast knockout. You watch box, right? When do you get knocked out? What happened to you when you are knocked out? You are out. You go to the carpet. You don't get up anymore. You are no longer functional. That's the same concept. Okay? When you knock out a gene, that gene is no longer functional. And sometimes I ask my students, and then what? You knock out a gene, then you can see a new phenotype in that cell. That's what we call reverse genetics. Okay? You don't look for phenotype and then find a gene. No. You knock out the gene and then test the phenotype. You go backwards. Okay? Mendel looked the phenotype, and then they start looking for the factors until they got the genes. Now we chase the genes. But when you do this work with yeast and you want to study, for example, a specific gene, you saw a sequence and it looked like it has homology with some other gene that has in that species, or there's some similarity with something you know. What is this one doing? That's when you use reverse genetics. You knock out that gene, and then, since the cell does not have it anymore, then you look for the phenotype of that individual. That's what I have been doing with yeast, and I have done a few knockouts myself, but nowadays there are banks that you can actually ask for any knockout you want. Someone will have it available. Probably the one that you make, they ask you, provide us what you have, and you give to them. And there are companies that basically make living creating knockout mutant species or mutant cells of any line of cells you want. So that's what I have been doing with yeast, to study different types of stress that I have had. And I have been interested mainly in what? Couple of genes that are called, they are in the family of aldehyde dehydrogenase, and I have four acetaldehyde dehydrogenase genes. And those four genes are what I call ALD 3, 4, 5, and 6, and those are the genomic annotation for those genes, and that's what they are called, and they are part of the big aldehyde dehydrogenase families. And interesting, pay attention here, This one acts in the cytoplasm, ALD4 and ALD5 in the mitochondria, ALD6 in the cytoplasm. In addition, I have this group of lines that I have been studying also. PDX, YLR, those are aminotransferase. This one is GABA aminotransaminase, and this one is pyruvate decarboxylase, three different isogenes, if you want, and ILV, CHA1, and all this, and I will show you PDX. We have studied, actually, we have a publication on that, implants and Arabidopsis also. PDX is pyridoxal phosphate, okay? So what I have been doing, I have been studying these different genes, and I use the mutant or the wild-type strain is the BY4743, and those are the mutant strains. And I have a student right now, when they are under the control experiment, that's how they behave. But I have been testing them for salinity, osmotic, and oxidative stress. And oxidative stress is very important because the effect that, before I tell you, you hear people talking about taking antioxidants. Why? Everyone is concerned about cancer. And antioxidants may actually scavenge free radicals. And then those free radicals can cause damage to different molecules, to proteins, to DNA, and so on, because they are highly reactive species. And that's why they're called ROS or ROY, reactive oxygen species or reactive oxygen intermediates. And because they are highly reactive and they can cause damage, they can actually oxidize other other molecules, that, molecules of interest. That's why I have been studying this, and as you can see, where you have more than one, like here, this means that is highly sensitive, that strain is highly sensitive to what? To osmotic, but also highly sensitive to oxidative stress. And that's PDX, which we already have a publication about that. But here I have this ILV1 that shows to be also sensitive to osmotic and oxidative. And YFL, which is a alanine glyoxylate aminotransferase, is also sensitive to what? Salinity and osmotic stress, but not to oxidative. So the student that I have has been actually studying all this, just looking for their phenotype in different environmental conditions, and then from those group we will select the ones that actually are worth to study, because they may be important for other things, but they may not be important for our interests. That's why he was working, making this table, to make sure that we are going to select the ones that are interesting for us. And what they do, as a curiosity, so PDC5, for example, is a decarboxylate pyruvate to acetaldehyde and carbon dioxide. And so some actually have a known function right now. And I have seen some interesting result with them. And YFL catalyzed scenes of glycine to glyoxylate. Okay? So I left this here. Then I concentrate my work on acetaldehyde dehydrogenase, the four ones that I showed you before. Why am I interested in aldehyde dehydrogenase? That's exactly what they do. They basically transfer, okay? They transfer the, they convert aldehydes into organic acid, okay? They oxidize them into organic acids, and with the production of NADPH or NADH, which is very important. So the four genes I told you, acetaldehyde dehydrogenase, the ALD3, 4, 5, and 6, they belong to these families, and they do similar thing. They convert aldehyde groups into organic acids. And in this work, I introduce a new component, caffeine, synthetic caffeine. Why? Because there are many work that has been published that shows that actually caffeine minimizes the damage of free radicals. Okay? It minimizes the damage. The process it does, it's not well understood. And if you look the structure of the caffeine, it looks like what? A purine. Okay? Look like a purine, like the nitrogenous base that you find in nucleotides. Adenine and guanine is exactly like caffeine. Okay? So what I have done with those four acetaldehyde hydrogenase. And if you remember, two of them are in the mitochondria, and two of them are in the cytoplasm. And most of the free radicals are generated in the mitochondria as a result of our own metabolic process. So probably if you have a gene whose product acts in the mitochondria and is involved in getting rid of free radicals, if you knock out that gene, that cell will become more sensitive to the presence of free radicals. And the hydrogen peroxide is one of those that can accumulate, or superoxide or superhydroxide. And if you don't have those enzymes or compounds that may accumulate to scavenge those free radicals, you become sensitive. And in our study, we found that we use hydrogen peroxide as the agent to cause oxidative stress, and we noticed that both ALDs, 3 and 4, the knockouts, this is the wild type, and both knockouts becomes more sensitive to oxidative stress, because here are different concentrations of the yeast cells that we added. And as the concentration goes down, the growth decreases. The wild type still grows at this level, but ALD3, ALD4 stop growing. I didn't use the rest because I just wanted to select. It's cumbersome. I just wanted to select two representatives, one in the cytoplasm, one in the mitochondria. That's why I only have two, but I can assure you, you can take my word as the truth, the 5 also is more sensitive than the 6. But previously, this is what a student did a couple of years ago, but previously I had this work that I did it myself, and I used different level of hydrogen peroxide. As you can see, 0 millimolar, 1 millimolar, 2 millimolar and 3 millimolar in liquid culture. This was run overnight, which means I spent at least 18 hours in the lab without going home. That's what it takes sometimes. And this is the wild type. And at both 3 different concentrations plus the control, look at the growth. Yes, when you go to a higher level, you start decreasing the growth as compared to the control. But look here, ALD3, that's the control, and then 1 millimolar, 2 and 3 millimolar. Basically, you stop growth as you increase the concentration. It remains almost flat. But 1 millimolar, you still have a good amount of growth, a good growth rate. But look the one that is in the mitochondria. Same concentration, 1 millimolar, you don't reach. Basically, that's the level you reach. And look in this one, that's what you reach. So if you compare, it's the same scale, and there's a great decrease in growth rate. The same as the one that you have at with the knockout in another mitochondrial enzyme. That's the growth rate even in the with the 1 millimolar if you compare to ALD3. And look, ALD6, that's also cytoplasmic. If you compare this growth and this growth, they are similar and higher than what you have in the LD4 and the LD5, which shows clearly that the ones that act in the mitochondria render cells more sensitive to oxidative stress as compared to the ones that are in the cytoplasm. Why? Because in the mitochondria is where you generate more free radicals. Nowadays, even cancer cells have created ways to escape death. There are cancer cells, all the poison that you use, there are cancer cells that are using those free radicals that may create, that would kill them, as a fuel to metastasize. There are research published about that. I don't know how deep, because I, for a couple of years, or at least 2 years, that I haven't searched, because I'm more concentrated in other things right now. But the last I read is, now even cancers are finding ways to escape being killed by some of those free radicals, that they can cause cell death as well. Okay, so this is what I have concerning those three or those acetaldehyde dehydrogenase. But I was telling you that caffeine has been shown to minimize damage in tissues and cells in rats, at least, when exposed to free radicals. And also they have seen some change in the response to the glutathione, which is very important in oxidative stress, and they have seen some effect of caffeine in the minimization of the damage by the presence of free radicals. So what we did, I had a student a couple of years ago that decided to grow those cells, and we used different treatments. And free radicals you can cause with hydrogen peroxide, but also paraquat, which is a herbicide, can cause also some type of oxidative damage. And then we subject those cells to different growth conditions, and we add caffeine, different level of caffeine, to the growth medium, and see if the caffeine would help to minimize the damaging effect of the hydrogen peroxide and paraquat. Concerning paraquat, basically there was no response due to the presence of caffeine. That's with paraquat, that's paraquat and caffeine, no much difference here. And so paraquat, caffeine has no effect on the paraquat. However, we saw some effect on the hydrogen peroxide. That's our control. And those are the three strands, the wild type, LD3, LD4. Okay, our control, medium without hydrogen peroxide. When we put 2 millimolar hydrogen peroxide, that's, and we detect what? The presence of reactive oxygen species using fluorescence. There's a method with a dye that when it binds to the hydrogen peroxide, it fluoresces. That work when you start at 8 or 6 in the morning, you finish by 10 o'clock at night. It's not because you stay there all the time, but you have to incubate the incubation time, so you have small window of time to go and come back. But you cannot stop. If you stop, you lose the whole work. That's the nature of this work. So when she put 2 millimolar hydrogen peroxide, look the increase in fluorescence due to the presence of free radicals as compared to the control. But this is the wild type, LD3, which is in the cytoplasm, LD4, which is in the mitochondria. So the knockout in the mitochondria, there is a higher increase of reactive oxygen species. When you add caffeine itself, even though I'm talking about caffeine, it doesn't mean that you need to go and drink coffee rampantly without control. Caffeine itself is a stressor. Caffeine itself causes stress in excess. In moderation, under certain level, you can have actually a beneficial effect of caffeine. And so when I put hydrogen peroxide and caffeine, if you look LD4, without caffeine, with caffeine. And when I have a higher concentration of caffeine, so there is a steady decline in the reactive oxygen species in the ALD4, which is the one that acts in the mitochondria. The same thing happens with the ALD3. There is a decline, and there's a between, there is a, where is it? Here, the decline is not as pronounced as here between the two, but there's a decline in the free radicals in the ALD3. Even in the wild type, there is a help also with the wild type when you use caffeine. So caffeine itself can help the presence, minimize the accumulation of free radicals in the cell. So we don't know the process yet, what happens, what is the effect of caffeine, but two other works have shown that, because I have a student right now, the one that is the sophomore now that is doing this. This is just about the survival rate. I'm skipping that. And this is the work that the other student did a couple of days ago. That's the piece of one of the results that she took to the meeting a few weeks ago. And what you have here is you have the wild type, the control, and 2.5 millimolar caffeine, H2O2, 0.075 caffeine, and H2O2 plus caffeine. There's a slight decline, nothing significant, but there's a decline. And when you use ALD3, there is an increase in the oxidative reactive oxygen species when you put hydrogen peroxide. And there is not, contrary to what we saw, the other student before saw a decline, but this student didn't see as a significant decline when you use ALD3. But when you use ALD4, which is the one that is in the mitochondria, and that's the increase in reactive oxygen species when you have hydrogen peroxide. That's just the caffeine itself, which lead me to tell you caffeine itself is a stressor. But look, when she puts caffeine and hydrogen peroxide, you come down to the level of the control without any treatment. So there is a significant decline in the reactive oxygen species in ALD4 knockouts when you combine ALD4, H2O2 plus the presence of caffeine, lead us to believe that there is actually a good response to caffeine. In addition to oxidative stress, we look also for the survival rate in the heat. Actually, both my students did it in the teaching setting, but also the student in the research lab. And both my research students and my students, academic students in my class, got exactly the same trend result. So there is a ALD3, 4 and 5, more than ALD6, have a lower survival rate as compared to wild type when you subject them to 50 degrees Celsius for 10 minutes. And then you go through a incubation process and you count for the amount of survival. So what can we conclude with this? The damage done by the hydrogen peroxide level at 2 is partially abated by the presence of caffeine in the growth medium. And the concentration of reactive oxygen intermediates decrease in the presence of caffeine, which may contribute to the increase in survival rate of yeast cell in the hydrogen peroxide. So even the survival rate may be increased. Not only you decrease the amount of the free radicals, but that increase may be significant enough to have a higher survival rate when you subject them to the hydrogen peroxide in the presence of caffeine. So, and this is what my students have been preparing to prepare the knockouts, to do the knockouts. Those you have to make large primers, because I have several single knockouts in one gene, but I have students now that are trying to do double knockouts, because to see if those genes have what, synergistic effect or if they act on totally separate mechanisms that leads to stress response. Because if they are synergistic, then if you have a double knockout, then the survival rate goes even lower. So basically, you may even having a problem that it may turn to be lethal, because the damage is so much that you cannot, the cells cannot tolerate it anymore. So this is what I have for yeast and Arabidopsis. But as I told you, lately in my lab, for the last 2 years, I have been working on a human project. I have a project with a couple of nephrologists in town from different hospitals, targeting the diabetic patients. Because people that go through dialysis, when that have kidney failure and they have to go through dialysis because they cannot, dialysis is an artificial kidney, the conventional dialysis does not remove all the toxins that piles up in the blood, mainly the uremic toxins, which are nonpolar organic compounds. And a lot of time, the accumulation of those toxins may lead to losing different sensitivity, olfact, vision, and so on. And so we have been detecting or working with four different human genes that encodes proteins that we believe that actually could select and could trap those uremic toxins that can accumulate in human blood. And so my lab has been working on cloning, expressing, and purifying those proteins that later they can prepare some cartridges that, like a colon that you use for dialysis, in the dialysis process, that could trap those toxins from the blood of the patient and then go back, the blood goes back into the patient, but the toxins will stay. So we have produced some of the proteins. We did some preliminary works using the machine I told you that I'm using for other purposes as well in other university. And so it's an ongoing process. We have hit some roadblocks, scientific roadblocks, but also bureaucratic roadblocks, because when you work with the humans, you have to be careful. There's ethical issues and things, and you cannot use human as a guinea pig. And I don't have to deal with that. I am in the scientific part, and the medical doctors, they are the ones who has to do things properly. But in addition to that, today, nowadays, when people that have to go through dialysis, they have to create some device. They have to put a catheter, and they have to basically join a vein and an artery where they suck the blood to go through the machine and so on. And what happens sometimes, there are some stenotic tissue. So stenosis is like, there will be like a scar tissue that creates, could be due to the circulation of the blood, but we have been working with a protein called lysyl oxidase, LOX, that actually, it's believed that those stenotic tissue is due to the cross-linking of some type of collagen fibers, and that cross-link. By cross-linking, then you tend to clog the vein and artery. So some doctors have to go inside and balloon it and break those tissues, but you can do it a couple of times, but after it's clogged, you have to move to another part of your body. And we have limited part where you can use that. And so basically, when you can no longer do that, the patient may get into a stage of renal failure, and basically you poison yourself with what accumulates in your blood if you cannot eliminate all those toxins. And if you can do it normally, fine, but so this is what we have been doing in our lab, and I hope you enjoyed it, and I could answer any questions if you have any.